and it actually lists all the requirements that you have. So, you start with technology capabilities, that means the technologies which I have listed, then you have your specification, and from the specifications you decide a process, the process with which you will actually do your work. Then you start with a circuit design, which is basically a design in schematic, and this is where the device models which we have discussed in the first lecture comes into picture. You require very models here. Then you do a circuit analysis, it requires CAD tools, and most of the CAD tools supports MMIC design and development. Then you have circuit optimization, then you go to layout. Actually, it is an iterative process. Once you go to layout, generally the optimization is gone. So, you need to go back to circuit analysis and optimization again. So, it is a iterative process. So, once you finalize this part, then you will do a DRC. There are design rules, and we will see what some of those rules are. Then you do design verification. So, this verification, again lot of things are checked at the verification level, and then finally, fabrication. So, if we try to simplify it a bit, this is how it is done physically. So, you start with an NDA, a non-disclosure agreement, because the foundry will be sharing proprietary information with you, and you are not allowed to share it with anybody, some of it, not all of it, some of it. Then process and kit selection, study of the design manual and PDK. This is a process design kit. PDK means a process design kit. Essentially what it does is that when you plug in a PDK to your circuit analysis software, it allows you to use the technology that the foundry will be using for their manufacturing process, and all the devices that the foundry is capable of manufacturing will be available inside your circuit simulator. So, this PDK does that. Then you start with schematic, then layout, and do a design rule check. After that, we do a tile construction. I will come to it what a tile is. Then you do a foundry design rule check. So, this design rule checks keeps happening. This is very, very important. So, this is done at the designer level, then the foundry level, and most of the time the foundry will find out some anomalies and sends it back to designer again to slightly tweak the design so that it conforms to the design rule check. And then you have a foundry design review, then you have wafer formation and mask generation and fabrication. Once fabricated, then there is something called PCM test. I will come to it what this PCM test is, and then dicing. Dicing means you will dice individual chips from the wafer, then visual inspection of dies to see that there is no anomaly, and then separation of dies into gel packs, measurement using probe station or measurement after packaging. Yes, you ladies have anything you want to ask? Okay, so this is again that step by step in a bit more detail. So, process and kit selection, your criteria, it might be low noise, it might be power, what is the highest frequency it can support. PDK models have to be studied for their limitation, also for operating current and voltage rating. Schematic you can do either in ADS or AWR or maybe in ANSOFT designer. Then optimized schematic design is imported into layout. As I was telling that when you do it in schematic, you do not capture all the electromagnetic effects that is present in your design. So, to capture that full electromagnetic effect, you need to take it into a EM simulator, and once you take it into EM simulator, generally the performance will vary quite a bit than what you have done in schematic. So, once you find out that the performance has changed, then you need to again take it back to schematic, and this goes on. It is an iterative process. So, it is optimized, and then here one more criteria is space. You need to make it as small as possible, because space is premium. The foundry will charge you for every square millimeter. Okay, depending upon process, the charge is somewhere between 1500 euro per square millimeter to 2500 euro per square millimeter. So, it is quite a bit costly. So, how much small you can make your total circuit, that determines the cost of the device. Then again, finished layout is checked using DRC. Of course, there is one more thing done here, which I will cover, which is called yield analysis, and we will see why yield is important. This is what yield analysis is done on optimized design, and a good yield suggests a reliable design for anomalies in the fabrication process. So, we will cover it, what these are. So, once the design is finished, then a tile is made. We will see what a tile is, with the required spacing to dice and additional process control monitoring cells are appended to the tile. Then these PCMs are calibrated modules of the foundry that are used to test the quality of the MMIC fabricated. What does it mean? It means that when you design a circuit, it is your intellectual property, and normally the foundry has got no access to your intellectual property. So, the foundry will not know what your design is supposed to do, only you know. So, you give them the only the layout, the foundry does not know what the circuit does, okay, whether it is an amplifier, it is a switch, it is a TR module, the foundry does not know it. So, once it gets fabricated, how do you know if something is wrong, that your design is wrong or the fabrication process is wrong? Either of one can be wrong. So, how do you circumvent this problem? So, to circumvent this, every foundry will have a very small tile, a very small area, where they will fabricate some standard structures. It is called PCM or process control monitoring structure, maybe one inductor, one HEMT, one capacitor, one resistor, like that. And for those standard structures, the results are known. If the fabrication is good, then the results are known. So, it is fabricated all over the wafer at certain places. Once the wafer is fabricated, these PCM structures are taken out of the wafer, and then they are tested, because the test results are already known. If the results are good, then the foundry will claim that there is no problem in the fabrication process. So, in your design, when you are making a tile, you need to keep space for this process control monitoring cells. Okay. Then this tile is populated into the required wafer size. That means, then this tile is replicated all over the wafer. No, there is no zooming out. What you do is, basically there is no board, no? Where is a board? Oh, anybody can lift it, so that I can simply draw and show you. Okay, this is enough. So, what you do is, let us say you have done some 2 or 3 mimic design, and this is one of it. This is the physical size, maybe this is 2 millimeter by 1 millimeter. You have your HEMT inside, circuit, inductor, etcetera, etcetera, and then one more here, some different size, 2.5 mm. by 1 millimeter. Then you will have something called a tile, in which all of your MMICs needs to be put like this. Whatever you have designed, does not matter. It is kind of a unit cell for fabrication, and there are rules on how you can make the tiles. Once you have made it, then your wafer is like this. This is the whole wafer. Then this tile will be replicated all over the wafer. So, this is one tile. This is how it is done. So, you have a tile. Inside the tile, you have the MMICs. And once you have done that, you need to only submit the tile to the foundry. Then what they will do is, they will take the tile and they will put it all over the wafer, so that this gets replicated many times. Which one? Testing. Okay. Yes, I will come to it. So, in every tile, you will probably keep the center zone clear. Okay. Here, you cannot put anything. So, that foundry will put their PCM cell here. Okay. So, see what happens is, it is a large area if it is a 6-inch wafer. Something might be, the fabrication might be good in this area, it might go bad in this area. You need to ensure that the whole wafer is good. So, how do you do that? You put PCM all over the wafer. You lose some space by that mechanism, but you ensure that there is no problem in fabrication. It is you. Cost is always on you. Yes, yes. But the cost is always on you. If you say that I do not require a PCM, they will not put a PCM. But then if something goes wrong, you cannot come back to the foundry and tell that your process is wrong.
PCM is verified at the foundry?
Yes. You will not get the PCM tiles back. They will take it out of the wafer. So, when you get the wafer, there will be blank spaces where the PCM was originally there. I will show you a photograph of that.
So, on different tiles,
it is the same PCM that is replicated all over.
And what does the PCM have? It just has a simple design.
Yeah, I will show you. I have expanded view of PCM also. It is nice to see that people are asking questions. Yes, you can have different. I will show you a tile, our own tile, which had around 20 different mimics.
20 mimics for one design?
One tile.
No, finally it will be for one design?
No. Amplifier, switch, mixer, different frequency.
And then you will cut it? Or?
Yes, we will cut it. Okay. So, we come to DRC, PCM and tiling, exactly what we were discussing. So, now we can take the curtain, I mean take that screen back. And something needs to be switched for the screen to come there. They will do. Okay. No problem. So, anyone in the audience who has done this previously? So, what is the design rule check? Why? I mean, these are the design challenges one need to face. What are the design rule check? The problem is that you cannot arbitrarily make circuits. You need to adhere to a very big list of stringent rules. Okay. You cannot do whatever you want. There are a lot of things are there and your hands are all tied. So, let us see some of them. Okay. Like when we start with the basic geometry of the CAD. So, if you have an MMIC of this size, the corner cannot be like in any arbitrary coordinate. It will be on a micron grid, as the devices are pretty small in size. So, the grid there is itself in micron. So, if you put a decimal, then after decimal these are submicron numbers. You are not allowed to do that. All your corner points has to be whole numbers. Okay. Then any angle other than 45 degree and multiples are not allowed. Only angle that you can use is 45 degree, or they are multiple 90. Polygon with more than 200 vertices, you cannot use them. Reentrant structure, that means if one structure partially enters another structure, that is not allowed. So, when we are putting an active device, this is the gate of a fate, only one gate, one single finger. All gates has to be horizontal. You cannot rotate it 90 degree and then put the gate in a vertical orientation, that is not allowed. So, all gates has to be horizontal. Like I am only listing some of them, there is a very thick book which comes along with the PDK. So, every designer, that is called a design manual, you need to read that book thoroughly and then see what are these design rules. You can design anything, but if it does not follow the design rule, it cannot be fabricated. So, these are challenges and constraints. So, okay, this probably will be slightly difficult for me to explain, but this is one thing I can explain. So, this is again, as I have shown, this is a gate. I mean, this is basically not a gate, this is a source. So, this is the source pad. So, as you are seeing, only 90 and multiples are allowed, no other. Only rectangular and in the same direction horizontal inclusion, inclusions are not allowed. Your length has to be equals to this, width less or equal to, spacing greater or equal to. So, all these numbers you need to keep in mind when you are designing. You cannot put arbitrary numbers. See, in microwave we all know we can put a line and then it will give me something. You can run an optimizer, you can find out a length which will give me what I require. You are not allowed to do that here. That you will be, but you cannot do it in a very straightforward manner. So, you need to go in a roundabout manner. Okay. So, probably let us say you find out a length, that length is not conforming to the design rules. So, you find out what is the nearest length which is conforming to the design rule. So, once you put that nearest length, then there will be some deviation in performance. So, you compensate it somewhere else, so that the performance comes back. Okay. So, likewise like this I have put, so all these gates again has to be on this side, horizontal side, you cannot put it on a vertical side.
So, this is you do using the simulator?
You can do using the simulator, but every simulator will contain a layout interface. Like if you use ADS, you have momentum. Momentum allows you to do layout. If you use microwave office, it has got its own layout tool. And once you plug that process design kit inside, then all the structures are available to you in layout. Okay, so this is like, this is a tile as I was showing. So, you have few MMICs here and this in between space, they are called dicing streets, because you need to dice it, you need to take this small IC out. So, you need to keep some space in between, so that it can be diced. Okay. So, here it is just shown slightly larger. So, as you can see, this part when enlarged, your dicing street width is 70 micron. This is for that given process which I am showing. So, depending upon the process, this dicing street's width might be somewhat different. Okay. It depends on the capability of the foundry, how small they can cut, how narrow they can cut. So, you need to keep this between your mimics, the 70 micron spaces. Now, you see the fun, this is allowed, this is not allowed. Why? Your dicing streets are not parallel. So, all dicing street needs to be aligned, like they cannot cut like this zigzag, it cannot be cut in a zigzag fashion. All will be cut in a straight line, very strict straight line. So, you see, you make a IC which is this small, but is it does not conform to this length, So, you need to keep some vacant space in the front and back of the IC, so that your dicing streets are all collinear. So, this is a problem generally we find when you are trying to put different designs into one tile. But if you have only one IC, then you do not face this problem. Okay. So, again this is a tile shown in an expanded manner. Now, how does the foundry knows what is the boundary of the tile? It need to know what is the boundary of the tile, so that the next tile can be formed. So, for that it places a e-beam mark at the corner. These two small rectangles you are seeing, they are e-beam marks. So, it will eat away space in your MMIC. So, the MMIC that you are putting in the corner of your tile, you cannot put any circuit in this region. The foundry will put their own e-beam marks there. You cannot put anything into these four corner regions. So, you need to keep it free. Okay. So, PCM I have already explained, so I will not explain it further. Minimum 20 sites per 4 inch wafer. So, generally in a 4 inch wafer you will have 20 PCMs, and this is what is called guaranteed. That means, if you use a particular technology, let us say a FET, it is guaranteed that the minimum IDSS is 200 milliamp per millimeter and the maximum is 460. So, there will be some performance guarantee from the foundry side, which you can take for granted, and you need to work within this guaranteed performance. You cannot expect anything more out of this guaranteed performance. This is a PCM pattern. Okay, so, this is replicated all over. As you can see, this is like an inductor, then you have this is a resistor. Then there are some standard patterns, which they will not tell us what the pattern is or what it does, but they have their own pattern, and this pattern they will put all over the mimic. This is how a tile looks, actual tile. So, you can see they are all different, these are dicing streets. Okay. These are dicing streets. You can see the dicing streets now. So, they are all different circuits. Okay. Does it looks intimidating? Do not be intimidated. Everybody is doing it individually, only one circuit at a time. Then you are putting it all together, that is all. Okay. So, this tile, this has also got its own rule that length and width, there is some ratio which you need to maintain. You cannot make it arbitrarily sized, and there is a max and a mean within which you need to keep the sites. So, as I was telling, that lot of challenges are there when you go into this kind of a design, because your design capability is limited by the capability of the foundry, what the foundry can fabricate for you. This is how the actual tile looks. This is a fabricated tile, same tile fabricated. This is the whole wafer, and you can see some black region, blank spaces, they are PCM, all taken out. These are black, these black regions are all PCMs.
Why do they make a round wafer?
It is easier to make. Yes, at the edge it gets wasted, because only half of the circuit will be printed or a quarter of it will be printed. Then this area will be wasted, because they need to hold it somewhere. The wafer needs to be somewhere, you need to hold it. So, this region is for holding the wafer. The wafer making mechanism is from ingots. So, that is a cylinder. From that it is cut, it is diced. So, it is always in this cylindrical fashion or a circular fashion.
So, this wafer they cut
into tiles? No. Yeah, this wafer you will cut into individual circuit, not in tiles. Tiles is for making it, but when you cut, you would not cut it like a big tile, you will cut individual. This is one mimic.
So, but here there are streets made for cutting?
No. Yes, definitely. You can see these brown lines. So, these are streets for cutting. does things make sense now, how it is done from start to finish? So now you can see this is the whole wafer and this is one tile. So this is replicated all over the wafer. Okay. So once you, I mean, this is, I have shown you the end result, but there are something in between. So you need to understand how the stack up works. So this is the stack up. So you start, as I told, with a semi insulating gallium arsenide substrate. On that you do an epitaxial layer by MBE, molecular beam epitaxy or something. Then you can start putting ohmic contacts for the drain, gate, etcetera. Then there is a nitride cap put on it to protect the ohmic contacts, and then boron implantation is done, and wherever you do not want implantation, you will put a very thick resist layer over that, so that the boron implantation does not happen at that place. After that, you can start putting in the gates. So you see, this is your insulating substrate at the bottom, this is your conducting channel. So this will essentially become your drain to source channel here. So what happens is, when you put a thick layer of photoresist, then and you do boron implantation, everywhere else this channel gets destroyed because of the boron implantation. It destroys the channel everywhere else. So you are left with the channel only at the space where you have put a photoresist. Okay. And then once it is done, you remove the photoresist and start putting in the gate. Okay, so you have your drain, source and gate. Okay. And then the gate is recessed inside, and here your active layer is also recessed by means of etching. Then once it is done, you put a passivation layer to protect it, passivation layer of nitride to protect it. And then you can form other things on top of this passivation layer, like the resistor. Here it is a tantalum nitride resistor, then it is a this one is a TIWSI resistor, and this can also be the bottom electrode of a metal insulator metal capacitor. So once you do this, then you can put another dielectric layer. That dielectric layer will form the dielectric for your capacitors, and on top of it you will have your final metal layer, which is basically a gold layer. This blue is a gold layer, and this is an air bridge. You see, it hangs in air. So why do you require air bridges? No, I will come to it. Okay. So once it is done, you need to metallize the bottom surface also. So the substrate is reversed, then the bottom side is metallized with gold, and wherever you require via hole, from top to bottom, that is also made by etching, and also you keep a small space here for dicing. Okay. And this is the final stack up, this is how it looks in the semiconductor. Okay. Now connect it with the circuit that I am showing many times. This is how the circuit looks finally. Okay. So and when you take it inside your simulator, then this is how the stack up will look, but they are not of all equal thickness, it is only for representation. You can see that this is the primary gallium arsenide bottom layer, which is 100 micron thick, but the next passivation layer is only 0.2 micron thick, a nitride layer. They are not to scale. Okay, that just keep it in mind. The bottom layer is thickest, and that is normally the thickness of the whole mimic. The rest of the thickness combined will be around 4-5 micron or so, not more than that. Okay. So I was talking about air bridges. So this is a spiral inductor. You have one end here, one end here. How do you take this end outside without shorting out the middle paths? This is a metallic spiral. So you require to take it up, then travel in air, then come down. So that is an air bridge. Okay, so if you are forming an inductor, then you need to necessarily have an air bridge to take one point you can take here just outside. Inside you need to use an air bridge to take it out. So these are different components available to you: MIA, metal insulator, metal capacitor, VR hole, DC pad, microstrip line, resistors. This is a PHEMT 6 into 40 micron, and this is a 6 into 40 microns is a gate length, and 6 means there are 6 fingers in the gate. Okay. And this is with source grounding. You have see two big pads here, they are VR pads. So the source are already grounded. In this case, the source are floating. So you can put something in the source. You have both the, you have selection of both type of components.
How does this research on the material go on? Is it with the
It's with the materials people. Mostly, it's with the material science people. Yes. Actually, it is not like that. You will probably start looking what is the characteristic desired of the material. Then accordingly, already material science is pretty advanced. So, you know from the periodic table how the material behaves approximately. So, from that you can start combining and then see whether some kind of, what kind of lattice structure gives you the characteristics. Yes, sir. We have used ADS, but anything can be used, does not matter. As long as the foundry supports their PDK on the CAD tool, whatever CAD tool you are using. People are using AWR Microwave Office, or they are even using Ansoft Designer. It is not the CAD tool which is important, it is the models that the foundry gives you that are important. Okay, the foundry will provide models to you. If the models are bad, then your design will not turn out right. So, lot of people what they do is, when they go to a foundry for the first time, they will simply fabricate individual components, resistor, capacitor, inductor, HEMT, etcetera, etcetera. And once it comes back, they will measure and then see whether the models the foundry has given is good enough for representing those devices. Cost is minimal, you can go for a like a shared mask kind of a configuration. Okay, so 3-4-5 lakh probably, it is not very large. So, once you do that, if you are satisfied with the foundry models, well and good. If you are not satisfied, as I have shown you in my first lecture, you can make your own models. So, lot of people do that around the world, they make their own models for simulation. They will not, because model is inside. You are to foundry, you are only giving a drawing, you are only giving a layout, you are not giving them model,
you are giving
only drawing.
Yeah, drawing is only the layout
drawing. Only the layout
drawing.
Huh, you are not giving anything else to foundry. Foundry does not even know what that drawing is supposed to do, whether it is an amplifier, whether it is a mixer, whether it is a switch, whether it is a multiplier, the foundry does not know. PDK, the process design kit. No, wafer is with the foundry. You only design here, send your layout to foundry. They will fabricate the whole wafer and send the wafer back to you.
And those steps, what you are telling that metal and
that is done at foundry, that you are not doing. But as a designer, you need to be aware what those foundry process steps are and what each process step does. It is for marking the border of the tiles, where one tile ends and where one tile starts. So, this is all for the process control. All these e-beam marks, PCM, etcetera, etcetera, they are all for process control. Okay. So, what I thought is I will take a case study, a very wide band low noise amplifier. 18 to 40 gigahertz. The application is basically ECM, electronic countermeasure. You can see the, you start always with the specification. Okay. So, you have some target specifications as shown, then you start with that. So, next step is you need to choose the process. So, you, since we went to UMS, United Monolithic Semiconductor, these are all the process listed. So, this process was selected because we are primarily looking at noise. and we are not primarily looking at power. It is a low noise amplifier, low power. So, this process was selected. It is a 150 micron gate process, very low noise. Then these are the main features of this process which are available. So, cutoff frequency is around 110 gigahertz, noise is around half a dB with a 14 dB of gain at 10 gigahertz and 1.9 dB with 6 dB of gain at 60. We are not going up to 60. And then these are the components available to you, passive components, air bridges, MIM capacitor, resistors, thinning and via holes. And these are some of the characteristics, and you have this FET available. You can pick the gate length and the number of fingers, there are some availability. So, how do you start? You start with this. So, again my question is, anybody has done low noise amplifier design in the whole audience? Yes, one. I can see only one finger, not even one hand. Okay. So, I will start with the basics then. Essentially what we do is that we always make design a cascaded amplifier, it is never in a single stage, it is almost always a multi-stage amplifier. Now, what is there to look for is that when you have a multi-stage amplifier, then the overall noise figure of these cascaded structure is given by this formula. So, this formula tells you that the noise figure of the first stage will be added straight away, but the noise figure of the next stage will be divided by the gain of the preceding stage. That means, contribution of noise from the next stage is less, because it is getting divided by the gain of the preceding stage. Likewise, for the further stages. So, that means, your first stage needs to be extremely low noise. Your next stage can have more noise. Now, why this is required? Why the next stage also cannot be of low noise? We can also make all the stages very, very low noise, then my overall noise figure will come down, but there is a problem. The problem is, let us skip this. So, this is the problem, I mean this is not exactly the problem, I will come to it in the next slide. So, what I would like to show you is that as you go up in frequency, the gain comes down, this is universal, and the noise figure goes up. So, this is what happens. If you have a hemt, almost always with frequency, the gain will come down and the noise figure will go up. And this is almost it is shown the same thing. So, this is with, this is when you choose how to choose the gate length and the finger. So, they are plotted for different gate lengths and fingers, gain and noise figure, and you need to reduce width and increase the number of fingers if you want a good noise performance. So, this is the problem that we face. The problem is that, see, in the x axis we have the bias, we can bias the device at many, many points, many different points. So, the bias is varied in the x axis. In the y axis we have plotted both noise figure and gain, associated gain. You can see the noise figure is minimum at 80 milliampere per millimeter bias point. We want minimum noise figure, but the gain is maximum at somewhat other bias point, 230 milliampere per millimeter. So, you cannot simultaneously achieve minimum noise figure and maximum gain. That is why the first stage you will select this bias point. This is your device characteristics. This is characteristics of the p-hemt, pseudomorphic high electron mobility transistor. Okay. So, you will choose the first stage, the first device, and bias it in this region, because contribution of noise from the first device is maximum, but you also want some gain in the overall amplifier. So, subsequent stages, yes, you will probably bias it here. So, that you get a better gain and you do not care about the noise so much, because it gets divided by the gain of the previous stage. Okay. So, this is another issue that comes. So, maybe I will use the board once more, then come back to this. So, I think this is turning out to be a bit more interesting than the previous lecture. Previous lecture was too dry. So, how do we design an amplifier in general? The basic technique is treat the device as a black box. Just take it as a two-port network, nothing else. Once you treat it as a two-port network, this is your active device. Then essentially what you will be seeing is there will be a reflection coefficient in the input and there will be a reflection coefficient at the output. Now, the standard technique for doing this, because you will be feeding it using some source with a source impedance and the power will be delivered to some load. This is how you do. Now, if you want maximum power to be delivered from source to load, then you need to use that maximum power transfer theorem. So, that means you will use a matching network in between. This matching network, this is called input matching network, will make sure that the gamma in here and the gamma source is complex conjugate of each other. So, essentially it makes sure that your gamma s is equal to gamma in star. So, if you do that, then maximum power gets delivered from source to the input of your device. Similarly, you will have an output matching network here. This will ensure that your gamma load is basically equals to gamma out star or vice versa, and this will also make sure that whatever power is coming out of this device after amplification, maximum power gets delivered to the load. This technique is called simultaneous conjugate match, because you are matching both input and output matching network using complex conjugate both in the input and the output. So, it is a simultaneous conjugate match. And this technique is used when you want to maximize the gain of the device. That means you want maximum available gain from the device, mag. Now, unfortunately, this is not true for a low noise design, because in low noise you need to match the input for the lowest possible noise figure, not for the maximum power transfer. And that input reflection coefficient is different than this gamma in, and that is generally denoted by gamma opt. So, if you match it to gamma in, there will be maximum power delivery from source to the input, but you will not be able to minimize noise figure. If you match it to gamma opt, then the noise figure will be minimum, but the gain will reduce, because there will not be maximum power delivery from input the network. Okay. So, the trick is, if your gamma in and gamma opt are close enough, if they are not varying widely, then you can probably match for gamma opt and still get a considerable good match for gamma in also. Okay, that is the trick, and now we will see how that trick can be achieved. Okay, somebody can put down the curtain. I put down the screen. So, as you can see, I have put in the gamma in and gamma opt on the Smith chart for three different transistor configurations, like this red, both red, one dotted and one solid. They are for a 2 into 50 micron device, 2 finger 50 micron gate. This dotted blue and the solid blue, they are for a 4 into 50 micron, 4 finger 50 micron gate, and the green is for 8 into 50 micron. So, as you can see, for the red case, the gamma opt and gamma in, they are widely different. So, if you try to match one, you will never be able to match another. For green, they are closer, but not close enough, but for blue, they are overlapping at a large region. So, if you select this configuration for transistor 4 into 50 micron, then if you match for gamma opt, you will automatically get a good enough match for gamma in. So, in that case, we will be able to achieve a good noise figure as well as a moderately good gain. Is it clear? So, see how this kind of tricks comes to a designer. You need to select the device, this is up to you, whether you will use 8 finger 50 micron, 4 finger 50 micron or 2 finger 50 micron, it is up to you. So, you need to put all these things into consideration and then select the appropriate one which is required for your design.
What are the dimensions?
They are the gate length, sorry, the gate width, not the gate length. Okay. The gate length is fixed for a process. Okay. So, this is a schematic design, this is how we design the topology of the amplifier. So, you have the first stage here, the second stage here and the third stage here. So, generally you will use some kind of a stabilization network, a DC blocking capacitor and a decoupling network at the bias. This is important because when you are putting using this, then the output can go either way, this way or this way. And if it goes to battery, you see battery is an AC short circuit. So, it will get coupled to the input through battery, it will create a feedback. So, you do not want any output to go to your bias network. So, that is why you need to do a bias decoupling, you need to decouple the bias, and a way of doing it is putting a inductor here and probably a shunt capacitor somewhere. So, and this is done for all three stages, these are all in lumped. So, this needs to be converted to distributed. So, all these inductors, they have been transferred to this kind of radial stubs, then capacitors you can use metal insulator metal or other kind of capacitors which are available. Then when you do DC biasing, one of the most advantageous way of biasing it using a self bias configuration, because self bias you do not require to put a separate gate voltage. It takes care on its own. Otherwise, if your gate and drain are separately biased, you need to be careful. The gate needs to be switched on first. If you do not switch on the gate, the drain is on, and if you put on the drain voltage, it will short. So, the device will burn. So, you need to put in a gate voltage first, but if you do a self bias, then it is not required. Now, in conventional self bias, you do not use this. This resistor is normally not used, but with this, you can actually make it slightly insensitive to the process variation. How so? This is how. So, let us say you consider this. So, you have only this VGS here, there is no resistor put into the source, and this is how it will shift. This is nominal ID versus VGS, and this can go to here or here depending upon the variation in the process. Okay, there will be some variation in the process how you manufacture. So, that way it can shift quite a bit, you can see, because now your VGS is fixed, so it moves in a straight line. So, the delta IDS is quite high, but if you put in a resistor, then it will become a Ohm's law. So, it will have some angle instead of being a straight line. So, for the same variation, your actual delta IDS variation is smaller. This is the configuration on how you do it. So, it is a three stage amplifier, this is the first stage, this is the second stage and this is the third stage. These are all biasing, bias decoupling, etcetera, etcetera. So, I will take you, so this part probably I will skip. These are equivalent circuits of all the components available to you, and then you can simulate them to your heart's content. So, I will come here. You start with the DC characteristics of the FET that you would like to use, then choose a optimum bias point. And this bias point, as I have shown you, there was a figure in which I have shown that what current it needs to be excited with for getting minimum noise figure or maximum gain. So, accordingly we will select the bias point here. Once you do that, then you will do a noise figure and maximum available gain analysis, and this is a preliminary analysis. This does not tell you the final figure, it only preliminary tells you, okay, whatever you are trying to achieve is achievable. So, as you can see, the noise figure is increasing with increase in frequency, and the gain is decreasing with increase in frequency as expected. Then you do a stability analysis. So, in stability you need to figure out these two things, which are k and delta, and for unconditionally stable device you need to have k greater than 1 and delta less than 1, which as you can see is not happening here. So, you have a k value of around 0.53, which is less than 1, and delta value of around 1.39, which is greater than 1. So, it is an unstable condition, and in unstable condition all your stability circles will come inside Smith chart. If you draw the stability circles in a perfectly stable condition, all these lines will go outside Smith chart. So, how do we achieve stability? We can do it by putting a resistor, series resistor here, a shunt resistor here, a shunt resistor here, or a shunt inductor here in the source. So, this last technique, it is called source loading. It is very popular with LNA designers. The reason is that the moment you put in a resistor, it will introduce its own noise KTBR that will get added to whatever LNA you are designing. You do not want that, you want to make it low noise. So, the best way of doing it is add a inductor here. The penalty that you pay is it reduces the gain a bit. If you put an inductor here, it will have an additional obstruction in your drain source line, and that is the line through which your current flows, AC current. So, it reduces the total gain a bit, but it is still a very good method for achieving stability. Then you design the bias decoupling network, as I was telling that this is the bias decoupling network. This is how it looks in layout, okay, and you see that nothing is going from 0 to 40 gigahertz, because it is a 18 to 40. Your S to 1, that is transfer from your output to bias, should be very very low. As you can see, it is very very low. Then you do the noise matching of the input of the first stage. As I have shown that the first stage needs to be matched for optimum noise, that means instead of gamma in you will be matching for gamma opt. So, this is the noise matching of the first stage, and this shows how the noise figure varies with frequency. It starts around 1.25 dB and rises up to around 2 dB across the frequency band 18 to 40 gigahertz, and the gain also it starts this is the return loss. So, the return loss is also less than 10 dB or so. You will not get a very good return loss here, since you are matching for noise, you are not matching for the gain. Then the output stages, that was the input stage. The output stages we will do simultaneous conjugate match to get better gain. Once you do that, then you need to do interstage matching, because the output stages are differently matched and the input stage is differently matched. So, when you join the two, there will be some issues. So, you need to do interstage matching to resolve those issues. Then this is how the whole amplifier looks, the full amplifier, and this is the layout of the full amplifier, cascaded multistage low noise amplifier. This is the EM simulated results. You can see that the noise figure is starting from around 2.5 dB or so and rising up to about 4.7 dB. This is your return loss and gain. So, the gain is around 15 dB across the band. So, it is a very flat gain across the whole band, and these are stability factors, and you can see now no blue or red line is coming inside the Smith chart. So, it is absolutely stable. After that, you need to do what we call is an yield analysis. So, the job is not finished yet. So, why do you require to do an yield analysis? Because when the foundry fabricates, due to process variation, it will have some variation in the response. What do I mean by that is that, let us say you have designed it like this. This line has got a width of 50 micron. Your design requires the line to be in a width of 50 micron. But when the foundry fabricates it, it cannot be 50.000000 micron. It is not physically possible. So, they will tell that we will fabricate it with a plus minus 2 micron tolerance. That means, it will be anywhere between 48 to 52 micron. So, that will change the response of your design, since you have designed it for 50 micron. But these changes are inevitable. They will happen because of the process variation. So, you need to take that into account. So, in the PDK, the foundry includes what the process variation can be. You select randomly 500 different variation of 500 different parts and then see whether your response is still within requirement. If it is still within requirement for most of the cases, then it is a good design. Okay, like in this case, we did a pass of about 250 and then in 250, 12 cases failed because of this process variation. It is around 278 or so, 266 cases passed. So, the 95% chips which is going to come out will be with the desired response. So, we say that the yield is around 95%. Okay. So, that is also one place where you lose. Like if you make 2000 components, all 2000 will not be working to your requirement. There will be some yield like 90%. So, that means out of 2000 you are going to get around 1800 devices which are good. So, this is the actual fabricated mimic that you have seen, that case study. These are actual measured results. Okay. So, like you can see, this is the theoretical noise figure and this curve is the actual measured noise figure. It is not, it will not exactly match, but it is close. It is better in this region, slightly worse in this region and even better in this region. And this is the gain and the return loss. So, we are getting about a gain of 16 dB or so with an input VSWR of 2 and output VSWR of 7. And this chip is 3.0 millimeter by 1.5 millimeter. So, this is a large photograph, but the actual thing you cannot see with naked eye. You need to see it under microscope. These are some of the other designs. I will just quickly pass through them. So, this is a distributed amplifier in a different configuration. This is a 60 gigahertz LNA that we did. So, these are the responses. Then this I wanted to show you. This is a quadrupler. That means, normally this is how you generate frequency at 60 gigahertz. You can generate frequency easily at lower frequency like Ku band, then you can multiply it up. So, here whatever you put in the input, 4 times will come out at the output. And this photograph is taken when testing was going on. So, this is the DC probe at the input and the output. I shown you in the previous presentation how the probes are used for measurement. So, these are probes and then these two are DC probes. These are RF probes and these are DC probes. These are for biasing. One is for VG and one is for VD. So, these are like results, some of the experimental results. 57 gigahertz. These will be the other harmonics. So, medium power amplifier. So, I think with this we come to an end to the MMIC presentation. Anybody has got any query?